Showers are making their way out of the state this evening. Here's a live look at the radar after a wet weekend. We've been slowly watching that move through. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. I'm Sarah Horbach-Witz here with meteorologist Corrales Ortiz, the expert on the topic of how long is the rain staying? When's it coming back? Yeah. Everything we need to know.
Well, we saw plenty of rain since the early morning hours, and that's kind of just making its way on through. Fortunately, anything severe was pretty much on the lower end of things. We did see a few gusty winds out of some of these storms, but a lot of the activity has pretty much made its way on out. As you mentioned, we're still tracking a few little showers making its way across parts of Interstate 40 near Johnson, Pope County there, just outside of Clarksville, north of Russellville, and then just to the south of the metro, maybe a little bit of a light drizzle, but mostly the activity is spotty at best. Parts of Grant to Jefferson County seeing a few spotty showers towards the Delta region as well. It was a very cool afternoon. Highs barely struggled to reach 80 degrees for us here in the metro in many locations, ranging anywhere from upper 70s to low 80s. Matter of fact, the last time we saw highs below 80 degrees was back almost a month ago on June 12th, where high was around 79, just like today. Average highs this time of year is around normally 91, but we have some heat on the way in the forecast. That's what I'll be talking about coming up.
Late last night, Pope County deputies found a 17-year-old with a gunshot wound. This after the sheriff's office responded to a call of gunshots on Bowers Loop north of Russellville. The victim was pronounced dead at the scene, and officers determined a 15-year-old suspect fled the area and later arrested him in Russellville. They were brought to a juvenile detention center waiting on formal charges. The community of Fordyce is a tight-knit one, and right now they're hurting after a business owner lost their building in a fire on the 4th of July. Tonight, THV11's Jalissa Garza spoke to the store's owner and tells us how the community is showing up for Mav and Me Boutique.
Along Main Street in Fordyce, you'll find several businesses.
Main Street, is kind of a unique place for us here in Fordyce.
Mayor John McNichol says it's the heart of this town.
We keep striving and pushing and trying to keep Main Street alive.
One of the popular businesses is Mav and Me Boutique. The business started inside Samantha Brandon's home, and in 2020, they joined Main Street.
When we found the building on Main Street, it was just like God told me that's where he wanted me to be.
Brandon and her husband eventually buying the building next door.
We were like, you know, that's a great opportunity for us to expand.
On July 4th, she received a call she didn't expect. Her business was on fire.
I just didn't think it was real, and I woke my husband up and I was like, the store's on fire. And when I got here, there was just smoke coming from the vents and my heart sank. I didn't know what to think.
Brandon plans to rebuild in the same location, but for now, she says she'll continue running her business the same way it started, from home.
A hard new beginning, but it's going to be okay.
And people who call Fordyce home offering to help.
Random people have been reaching out like, hey, you know, I have a heat press. You're more than welcome to use it. People have offered me their embroidery machines.
The mayor says the doors being closed along Main Street will hurt, but he is rallying behind her too.
It's like family. I mean, everybody pulls in together, and it's been devastating for everybody. I mean, even the people that probably didn't shop there. It's really hurt Fordyce, the downtown area. I'll do anything I can to help her.
And Brandon is holding on to hope for the future.
It's hard to see it, but it's going to be okay.
In Fordyce, Jalissa Garza, THV 11 News.
Today's rain may have brought some cooler weather in central Arkansas, but an intense heat wave continues across much of the country with dangerous conditions in some places and no relief in sight. And global heat records are raising alarm about a warming planet. Bradley Blackburn reports.
The heat of the summer is here, no matter where you are or who you are. The president and first lady hit the beach in Delaware Saturday, soaking up rays in the ocean breeze right by other beachgoers. Everyone is looking to beat the heat, which in many places is at extreme levels.
Try to be done out of the fields by noon at the latest.
In the Southwest, excessive heat warnings are expected to last through the week. Phoenix has hit at least 110 degrees every day this month. Temperatures that can be dangerous.
It's not uncommon within 30 minutes to be unconscious from the heat.
In Wildwood, New Jersey, a fire at a substation knocked out power for tens of thousands, meaning no fans, no air conditioning.
I'm sweating.
The Earth itself broke heat records last week, with global temperatures reaching all-time highs. And scientists say it's more evidence of a changing climate.
In a word, human-caused warming. It's not rocket science. You make the planet hotter, you're going to get more frequent, intense, long-lasting heat waves.
Extreme wildfires are also a growing threat, like the Canadian fires that have polluted the air for millions of Americans.
We need to be removing greenhouse gases from the atmosphere, including planting more forests, taking better care of grassland and agricultural soils, removing carbon from the atmosphere, and cooling the climate.
A global problem heating up as millions try to cool down. Bradley Blackburn, CBS News, New York.
And researchers over in the UK are trying to determine how hot is too hot for humans, weighing factors like the body's energy consumption and heart functions against rising temperatures. Scientists determine the tipping point is somewhere between 104 and 122 degrees Fahrenheit, but it's not clear whether humans can further adapt to the danger of extreme heat. A new lifeline for those in the early stages of Alzheimer's, already giving hope to those affected. The FDA gave full and final approval to Leqembi yesterday. It helps slow the decline. NTHV11's Ian Russell spoke to someone with a unique perspective on the treatment and has that story.
Said I'm going to do nothing but enjoy life, my golden years.
Life has a funny way of throwing curveballs when you least expect it. One, Mark Alloway already knew his mother has Alzheimer's.
For my case, it was a shock.
But he never thought he would be in that same situation.
I was an A++ person. I'm maybe a D right now.
3 years ago, Mark was diagnosed with vascular mild cognitive impairment. Things have gotten harder for him. Names and faces are difficult.
My reading ability, I have to look up words I used to know. And that's what the biggest thing is, just losing what I had.
It was a harsh reality. One family member who couldn't remember, he on his way to losing those memories until Thursday.
Excited. I was very excited. I'm the perfect person.
The FDA approved Leqembi, a drug shown to slow the decline of memory and thinking by nearly 27%. That delays the disease by months. Mark isn't the only one looking forward to this. Dr. Jean Wei, director of the UAMS Reynolds Institute on Aging, works with patients in the early stages, like Mark, to those farther along, like his mother. She says it's been nearly 20 years since the last time a major breakthrough like this happened.
We've been waiting and waiting for something to come along, and I can tell you everybody has been looking for it.
Any help is good help, she says. Leqembi may only slow the decline, but that means more time with loved ones.
A few months is huge, and that's all we can say is this is just priceless, and it's been shown to really be true.
Officials with Medicare announced they'll step in to help cover costs, meaning more people can access the treatment. It's a lifeline that means a lot to Mark.
If I can live longer enough to watch my kids, grandkids and great-grandkids graduate from high school or college, that would be great.
He thought his diagnosis was that curveball in his life, but sometimes life sends you one more.
It gives me hope, and that's what I want people to understand.
In Little Rock, Ian Russell, THV 11 News.
And with that hope, there is also a lot of information to understand about Leqembi and what it can do and what it costs. We have all that information and other resources on our website at THV11.com. From one medical breakthrough to another, the FDA recently approved the first of its kind non-hormonal treatment for hot flashes, one of the most common and unpredictable symptoms of menopause. Hot flashes are brought on when estrogen and progesterone levels are low and women have a harder time regulating their body temperature.
It's not just a feeling of being hot, it's a feeling of burning up from the inside out.
Tonight at 10, Wake Up Central's Karen Fuller will take a closer look at the new treatment and the impact it's already having in one patient's life. Today, the newest exhibit celebrating 100 years of Arkansas State Parks opened at the state capitol. The natural state is home to 52 parks and over 55,000 acres in the state park system. The state park centennial exhibit will stay on display as part of the state capitol's first floor galleries until August 9th. The exhibit comes as the state welcomes a new Arkansas Game and Fish Commissioner. Wednesday, Governor Sarah Huckabee Sanders named Brandon Adams to the role. She described Adams as someone who cares about the state and the outdoors and wants to make sure that every Arkansan has access to the great resources we have right in our backyard.
I feel like living and hunting and fishing and working in so many different and diverse areas of our state gives me a unique perspective as to their needs related to conservation and habitat management. I look forward to getting to know this amazing group of commissioners, as well as the incredible state or staff at Arkansas Game and Fish.
Adams is the CEO of a nursing home chain, and he replaces Bobby Martin, whose term ended after 7 years on June 30th. Oklahoma is seeing tons of damage after storms early this morning. After the break, we'll take a closer look at those flooded rolls and downed trees. Corrales?
Well, Sarah, the last few days we've had a little bit of an active pattern, but the forecast is going to change a little bit heading into the new week. Rain chances will be slightly lower, but temperatures are going to be on the rise. More details coming up.